Darien Gap is at the Darien Isthmus, the Panama Isthmus, that little sliver of land between Panama and Colombia. There's no roads there for more than 100 kilometers, about 102 or 3 kilometers, so more than 60 miles, right? No roads. And some of the roughest jungle in the world, really sticky mud. It's got special mud and some serious mountains and very dangerous rivers, flash floods. It's a rainforest. A lot of biological problems with the various diseases out there. A lot of the migrants die from waterborne diseases, and many are just washed away in flash floods. At least 10% are dying going through. And this month, there'll probably be 8 or 10,000 go through, which means 800 or 1,000 will probably die this month in the jungle. And almost nobody knows about these. Well, I've been out there. It's true. I took a few congressmen, or two congressmen out there recently with Chuck Holton. We took Tom Tiffany and Burgess Owens out there, and they actually went to the jungle. Extremely courageous. Went beyond the edge of everything. The only security was us and us, the Indians that we were with, and went out and dug out canoes, and they saw the carnage of the people coming through the Darien Gap. The Darien Gap is the ultimate wall. If you're super fit, you're like Rambo fit, and the weather smiles on you, you can get through in 4 days if you don't get lost, right? Most people take at least 7 or more. One guy just took 22. That was abnormally long, and he actually survived. But many people just get lost out there because there's no, they follow false trails, and they just vanish forever. For instance, a family asked me yesterday to help them find some of their family that was lost in 2016. Of course, the chance of that are very slim. Many of the migrants who are coming up through Mexico actually have to start in South America because they can't start in Mexico. They can't get a visa to Mexico. So they start in three major countries in South America. They start in either Suriname. That's where many of the Cubans and the Haitians go. They go to Suriname because they don't need a visa. And Suriname is that little tiny country in the north part of South America. It's an old Dutch colony, so Dutch is one of the languages. And so they'll go there. And then from there, they'll take a bus to either Brazil or Ecuador, and they get up to Colombia and cross. Now, so they'll either go to Suriname, Brazil, or Ecuador to begin with because they can get visas on arrival.
So let's jump into the Darien Gap side of things first, before we jump into the Europe side. Now, you mentioned an incredibly disturbing number, and I just wanted you to kind of qualify this for me. You said that 10% don't make it, 10% going through the Darien Gap die along the way. Explain this to me. How are you getting these numbers?
My good friend Chuck Holton, a very experienced war correspondent, we've been down there quite a lot together. In fact, we're going to be back in the Darien Gap in about 4 days from now. He puts the number higher. He puts it at 1 in 7, which would be more like 14%. How do we get the number? That's a very good question because we don't know how many go in and we don't know how many come out. So how do you get the answer? How do we get that estimate? We've interviewed many, many migrants, just unbelievable numbers.
So I met this Somali woman in Tapachula who came through here about 6 weeks ago. She said, I said, "Did anybody die?" And she said, "Man, there's dead people everywhere. I saw all kinds of dead bodies." She said, "People fall off of things, they drown, they get washed away, they die of dysentery, just everything." And she said there were several people who were still alive, but couldn't go any further. They couldn't walk, and so they were just waiting to die out there. One woman was a big, heavyset woman that couldn't make it up the hill of death, and so she had been out there, she said, for 24 days. People kept feeding her, but she couldn't go back and she couldn't go forward. So she said she was just waiting for God to take her.
And we'll ask them, how many people did you see die? How many got lost? How many? And it clearly looks like about 10%. For instance, recently one group of 40 went in and 20 died. That was abnormally high. Most of them were killed in a flood. Often the floods will sweep away many people at once. There's flash floods out there, and they'll sleep beside the rivers because it's clear. And then, wow, flash floods. That's pretty severe. Even the Embera Indians who live out there, those are the ones that take Chuck and me out there. The Embera Indians, even they are running from the flash floods. And so a lot of them fall. Actually, many of the migrants fall. They have to go over three mountains. And that third mountain, they fall off of that one quite a lot. You saw a video that I sent to you. That was a little rough. That's not as rough as a lot of the places. Many of them drown. Many are drinking water that's tainted. Many of the children die. Many children, like even 1-2 years old, pregnant women going through, many of those die out there. You'll see many children coming in with no parents because the parents died out there. And like one Haitian man, I found him in Bajo Chiquito. It's a small village way out in the jungle. No electricity, no phones. And I asked if these are his girls. And he said, no, their mother almost died, and she's in the clinic in the tent, actually, which was near us. And the girls were, they looked pretty scared. They were like 3 and 4 years old or so. And he said he took both of the girls and helped the mother as much as he could. I would say 80% of the people that come in have no shoes because the mud pulls their shoes off, or their shoes aren't good to begin with. So they got bloody feet. And often they're being carried in by some big guy that's still strong enough to do it. Other people come into Bajo Chiquito village and they die. Many of the migrants, by the way, are also murdered out in the gap. They get murdered by bandits out there. And many are raped. You'll hear many, many stories of women being raped, especially Cuban women. And so huge stories about that. I've published some of them actually on Epoch Times.